तत्सत् नमः शिवाय।
Thank you for being here this morning. It seems somewhere on the way. Somewhere on the way to the canteen. Or maybe on the way to the museum, maybe. But anyway, thank you that some of you could make it up to be here. So thank you. And now, let us think in the same direction as the topic presented by the learned speakers this morning. We had two speakers this morning, one Dr. Sandwise, another is Swamiji from Paramahamsa Yogananda Yogada Society. The topic was from form to formlessness. Let us focus our attention on the topic. I'm not a Swamiji, and I'm not any scholar, but having heard his talks for 40 years and having translated his talks for 23 years, I begin to recall, I begin to recollect what he said in the past on the topic, form to formless. I'll give you illustrations, examples relating to the topic given by Baba only. None of the things are my own. What did he say? First, he gives one example. When child starts learning, how does the child starts learning? There's a picture of a cat. Under that, C-A-T, cat. There will be picture of a rat. Under that, R-A-T, rat. There will be picture of a bat. And then B-A-T. So child learns from those pictures first. When the child sees the cat, this is the word. Rat, this is the word. So words are understood. First, by looking at the pictures, right? Later, when the child comes to higher classes, say fifth class, sixth class, if I write C-A-T, it is enough. I don't draw the picture of the cat again. Cat is enough. If I write rat, it is enough. I don't have to draw the picture of the rat. So the learning starts from pictures, then to letters, later to sentences, then books, volumes, like that. The study of the volumes all initially begin with pictures, right? Am I right? This example given by Baba. So picture is a form And the study later, without picture, is formlessness. So in our studies, in our alphabets, in our learning, to whichever country we belong, form to formlessness, meaning pictures first, next letters and sentences. This is the example given by Baba. My friends, when Swami has given so many examples which are applicable, experienced in our daily life, where is the need to confuse people? Not necessary. Avatar has put it in such a simple way. Then second example, all these are from Swami's books. On the Independence Day, what do you do? You salute your national flag. What is the national flag? Piece of cloth. Why do you salute it? That cloth represents the whole nation. South Africa flag. Yes. Because the flag represents the nation. The nation is not the flag. The whole nation is not the flag. Flag represents the nation. Nation is so big. Mr. Ken tells me, Ken always tells me, you cannot come to South Africa for 2 days and go back. It needs 10 days. He always tells me, with all his big eyes, 10 days. He says 2 days impossible. So South Africa, such a big nation, has got a small flag, piece of cloth. So nation is not the flag, but the flag represents the nation. Similarly, form represents formlessness. Form is the flag. Formlessness is the nation. Formlessness, the nation, is so vast. Flag, the form, is so simple and small. This is the second example Baba has given. Am I clear, sir? This is what we are supposed to do on the topic. And third example, what did he give? The third example he gives is this. It's from form to formlessness. Form represents a stage in the process of meditation. In the process of meditation, if I go on looking at you, I don't look at others. When I look at you, I don't look at others. So form will help me for the initial stage of concentration. Later form is not required. Because you concentrate, supposing my friend Lucky is here. I look at him. When I look at him, I don't look at anybody. All my attention is on him. It is concentration. Then what happens? I think of his qualities. A Spanish-speaking man. A man who spent long time in Spain. A good devotee. A close friend of mine. And a man, architect of the whole SaiWisdom.com website. All his qualities, all our friendly relationships, all our associations come to my mind. So, from concentration, I go to the higher level of thinking of our relationship, qualities, associations, events, occasions when we met. This is called contemplation. Second stage, contemplation. And then comes the third stage. I forget myself where I am. I go on thinking of him only. This is better known to youngsters. who are in the initial stage of love affair with their fiancés. Then once they're lost, totally, the beloved is in the mind. Alright, where are you? Huh? Did you call me? Yes, I called you long way. 10 times I called you. But you are not looked at me. Because his mind is on her. He does not exist. He is not there. He has become one with her. That is physical love. This is divine romance. This is also romantic. This romance is divine romance. Gopis had such divine romance with Lord Krishna. That gopis have forgotten themselves thinking of Lord Krishna. They have no knowledge of their body. They have no alertness of their mind. Constant thinking of Krishna. And the thinking of Krishna is so deep and intense that while going to the market with milk and curd to sell them in the market and earn their livelihood, they should say milk, milk, curd, curd, so that everybody would come and buy. Instead of that, they started shouting, Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. Are you buying or selling Krishna or what? Meaning, Krishna consciousness is so deep that they have forgotten the milk and the curd they are carrying on the head. This is the third stage when we forget ourselves, which is called meditation. So there are 3 steps. First, focused attention, concentration. Second, the qualities and the attributes, associations, intimacy, the proximity, being recollected, recalled, brought back to memory, and which is called contemplation. And third stage, when I forget myself, when I am lost and he alone remains, that is called meditation. Therefore, form is necessary for concentration. Formlessness is meditation. In formlessness, there is nothing like a form. It is totally formless. That is the ultimate state of meditation. In contemplation also there is form. Because you think of the qualities. Jesus, yes, I think of him good. His sacrifice, his love, his forgiveness, still form is there. So form is there in 2 steps. Concentration, contemplation. In 3rd step, the form disappears. Formless state. That's called meditation. So from form to formlessness, meaning from concentration to meditation. From concentration to meditation. That should be the concept. From form to formlessness. Actually, what is formlessness? What is form? What is formlessness? How can I imagine formlessness? Can you? Is it possible? Simple example. All from Swami. Supposing I am here at the center, surrounded by mirrors all around. In all of the mirrors around, I find my reflection, right? There are 10 mirrors, I find 10 of my reflections. Am I not right? So who is Anil Kumar of these 10 reflections? In a saloon, if you go to a hairdresser, there will be so many mirrors. You sit at the center, you find so many reflections. Who is Anil Kumar? is it number one or two or three? All are my reflections only. But there are 10 forms. 10 forms are the same object. Subject is being the same. And this is formlessness. Formless meaning feeling the one in everyone. Feeling the one in everyone, experiencing the one in everyone is the formlessness. But considering everyone one by one, one by one is formful worship, sakara. One by one. Yes, hello, how are you? How do you do? Nice meeting you. Hi, good morning. Glad to see you. One by one is formed. Seeing one in everyone is formlessness. I think I am clear. Am I clear? So, and another point is this. Anil Kumar is in this form. And you can easily make out. But, if everyone looks like me, who is Anil Kumar? You cannot say. Everyone is Anil Kumar. How can you say so and so is only Anil Kumar? In fact, because all are like him. The point here is, when God is in everyone, Purusha Prakriti Stori, Bhunte Prakriti Janu. God is present in everyone. Bijamma Sarva Bhutana. God is present in everyone. So there's God in you, God is in you, God is in you. Now what is the name of God? What's your name? Shashi. Yes, Desikan. Desikan. Good. Desikan. There's God in Desikan. Now what is the name of God now? Desikan. What's your name? Calton. So what is the name of God now? Calton. What's your name, sir? Fossil. Don't say fossil. So what is the name of God now? Fossil. So, all these are names of the same God. Same God is present in everyone. Now, what is the name of God? What is the name of God? All your names are His only. All your names are His only. Am I right? Because God is in everyone. Your name, God is in you, in you, in you. So, what is His name? All our names are His. So what is the particular name? No particular name. Because all names are His. That is namelessness. Nama Rahita. Namelessness. When God is in everyone, what is His form? Is He like Him? With the hair like that? Or is He like Him? With the t-shirt like that? Is He like Him? With the Sarvadharma mark on the t-shirt. He is like Him in this form. He is like Him in this form. Meaning, He takes any form that He gets into. He takes any form that He gets into. Simple example as Baba has given. There's air everywhere. If you pump air into football, what is the name of the air now? Football. When you pump air into lorry tire, what is the name of the air now? Lorry tire. If you pump air into the balloon, what is the name of the air now? Balloon. So air gets the name depending upon the one it gets into or pumped into. So, the formless air Formlessness is air, form is the tire. Form is the balloon, form is the tire, form is the football. One form is a football, one form is a balloon, one form is a truck tire, another form is a cycle tire or car tire, but same air is. Understood? There is no special air for lorry tire. There is no special air for cycle tire. Same air. Now what is the form of the air? Air has no form. Then why do you call it tire? It has gone into that. Why do you call it balloon? The air has gone into it. Understood? So, the air is formlessness. It gets the name depending upon the medium, depending upon the medium into which it gets into. Therefore, form and formless meaning. Forms are many. Forms are varied. Forms are diversified. Forms are colorful. There is variety in forms. This variety of forms, this diversified, formful composition is called nature or prakriti. Nature or prakriti is nothing but variety, complexity, composition, amalgam, combination. Take for example nature. There are mountains. Do you think there is no God in a mountain? God is there in an atom. God is there in an atom. In electrons, protons, God is there. So do you think there is no God in mountain? There is. Rivers, forest, valley, vegetation, flora and fauna, human beings, God is present in all of them. But some are mountains, some are rivers, some are oceans, some are trees, some are animals, some are human beings. God is in everyone. So, same God in so many varieties, in so many types, when expressed, it is called creation or nature. Creation or nature or prakriti is the expression of God in multiplicity, in complexity, in variety. Imagine. But the God basically is one and the same. And that oneness, same God present in everyone, is formless. Oneness is formlessness. Plurality, multiplicity, diversity, variety is formfulness. So there is formfulness, creation, formlessness, creator. Creator is formless. Creation is formful. Am I clear? Then next, take for example, in a balloon, only small air to some extent. In a car tire, little more air. In a truck, little more. In an airplane, some more. There will be quantity in difference of the air to be pumped. Am I right? Or would you pump same air into the balloon also? You can't do that. So, the quantity of air may be different, pumped into different media. But air is same. Similarly, creator is same. His expression is different. Divinity at a low voltage, at lower levels of awareness, at lower levels of consciousness, at lower levels of comprehensions, at lower levels of intellect and mind. That is all mineral matter. Mineral matter, same God, without much of awareness, without sentiments, without feelings, and seeing God with some more awareness, some more consciousness, in the course of evolution, gets into the vegetable world, or the green world, or the greenery, or plant world. And then develops intellect later. Dog knows whom to bite, whom not to bite. Ant knows what is a sugar particle, what is a sand particle. So, little more intelligence in the animal world. When he comes to the human world, he can be vegetarian and also a non-vegetarian. You cannot make a tiger vegetarian. Impossible. You cannot make a lion, please have sambar tonight. Thank you. Impossible. So, man can be, cannot be. Man can be what he wants. Animal cannot be what it wants. Tiger, even if he wants to be like elephant, it cannot be. Elephant cannot be like a tiger. They have no choice. Man has got a choice. Therefore, he acts like a tiger sometimes, acts like a serpent, most often a monkey, because he can act in any way. Because he has got the intellect. Therefore, mind and intellect minus passive inert, passive inertia, tamoguna, that is mineral matter, with little more sentiments, little more awareness, the plant world, the mind and the sentiments, that comes the animal world. The discrimination, discretion is the human world, same consciousness. Same consciousness. It is something like that. Fan regulator. When it is one, slow breeze. Two, little more. Three, five, six. If it is more of our Indian fan, it will fall on the head also. So, depending upon the regulator, the speed will increase, but air is same. Right? Similarly, the speed the consciousness awareness develops from mineral to plant, from plant to animal, from human being, but same divinity at different levels. The speed, momentum, velocity, the pace of consciousness and awareness, that is different. Same divinity. That same divinity all through is formlessness. That which takes different voltage, different levels, that is called formful. Same electricity. Bed lighter, dim. 40 candle, 100, some more. 500, some. Floodlights, full light. Same electricity. So what is the form of the electricity? Fan is working because of electricity. Mic is working because of electricity. Electricity in a mic is sound. Electricity in a fan is breeze. Electricity in a heater is heat. Electricity in a fridge, cold. So what is electricity? Heat or cold or freeze or sound? Where it is the mind? Yes, I am the sound. Where is the fan? Yes, I am the breeze. Same electricity. So, expression of the electricity in the form of the heat and the cold, the breeze, that is formfulness with a form. Same electricity, formlessness. So, formless electricity, formful fans, mics, fridge, heaters and all that. Is that clear? Then, we have in our villages, people use pots earthen pots. Pots. They take clay and make that clay into a pot. Pot is made up of mud or clay. C-L-A-Y. Clay or mud. Out of this clay, you can make a pot or a slate or anything like that. Right? All right. I've taken this mud, made a pot. I'm making use of this mud. Very good. Keeping water. Drinking that water. Natural friends. After some time, what happens? By mistake, I drop down. What will happen? It breaks. Breaks into what? Into pieces. Now what will happen? On the pieces of the pot, cars, lorries, human beings, bullock carts, all of them start moving. Finally, these pieces become clay once again. You understand? So clay becomes a pot. Pot after it breaks becomes a clay again. Please follow this point. This is the fundamental point, very necessary to this morning's talk. From form to formless, okay, I understand. Then what happens? From formless to? From formless to what? Form again. From form to formless. Formless to? Form again. I carry the pot. Pot falls down. It breaks. So many pieces. And those pieces slowly becomes clay once again. Understood? So from form to formless, from formless to form is a regular cycle. The regular cycle in the creation. Simple example. Baba, hear this example. You have gold with you. With this gold, you get a ring. Good. Later you feel, why ring? I can have earrings. What do you do? Melt it. Make earring this time. Yesterday, finger ring. Today, earring. But gold, same gold. That gold is formlessness. The finger ring, ear ring is only form. Form goes on changing. Same gold here. Indian ladies in those days, my grandmothers, great grandmothers, they used to wear that. Gold here, waist belt. I have seen pictures, photographs. Ah, broader than the policeman's belt. Made up of gold. Yeah. My grandmother used to wear that. And later years she was very thin. The belt is loose, but she doesn't want to lose it. So same gold here is waist belt. Same gold here is the ring. Same gold here is earring. Same gold here is the chain. Right? And chain can be made into waist belt. Waist belt can be converted into chain. And gold cannot be converted into gold is gold. Right? These articles, jewels, can be converted. But gold? Gold cannot be converted. Gold is gold. So, that which is not convertible, that which is constant, that which is eternal, that gets the shape and the place and the name, depending upon where it is located, like earring, finger ring, waist belt, and so on. That basic thing is formlessness. Basic gold is formlessness. the earrings, waist belt, these are forms. So out of formless gold, jewels which are formful have come. And when this earring is melted, what happens? Become formless. Waist belt, when it melted, what happens? Formless. So formless, formful. Formful, formless. It's a regular cycle. Why do you think formless is superior to formful? Why do you think formful is superior to formless? Then what is the way out of this? What is the way out of this? It is a cycle, I said. How to get out of this cycle? To get out of this cycle is called meditation. Meditation is the only process to get out of this cycle of form and formlessness. Why? How? Because of the gold located here, it has become finger ring. Because it has gone there, it is earring. Supposing it doesn't go anywhere. Gold is that. Do you call it earring? Here is gold. Do you call it earring or waist belt or finger ring? What is it? We don't give any name. The name gets because of space and time. You understand? Name and form are based on space and time. And it's the mind. It is the mind that is responsible for the form. How are you? South Africa. Yet? How are you? Don't you see me? 6 footer. Yet? How are you? Don't you see me with a broad smile? Yes, you are. How are you? Don't you know? Don't you find me quite healthy? Yes, you are. So these things are there depending upon the time and space because the mind. Simple example. Do you find any mad fellow? Mad fellow. We don't need to search for them. Most of the people are like that. Degree of difference. Our seniors are 100%. Next are 80, 70, we may be 40 to 30, but we have got some dose of madness we have. 100% our elder brothers, seniors, totally mad. You ask him, what's your name? You tell your name, not his name. Because he's a mad fellow. You tell somebody's name, not his name. Why? Mind is not working. If you ask him, have you taken your food? He'll say, bring it now. He had his food only now. You want the food to be brought now again. Why? Mind is not working. Name is forgotten. Place is forgotten. Time is forgotten. Identity is forgotten. Whole routine is forgotten because mind is gone. When the mind enters, would you like to have something? Yes. Would you like to eat again? No, no. I ate. But I would like to have some ice cream. Right? Because mind is there. I never said I have not eaten. I ate. But ice cream is awaited now. Don't you think so? So mind tells you what is what. Because mind is time. Mind is space. Mind is identity. Mind is ego. Mind is oneness. Separateness. And if you ask a mad fellow, give him some tea, sweet. Is it sweet? So, it's not at all sweet, he says. No mind. He doesn't know what is a sweet, what is not a sweet. So, this dual nature, sweet, hot, sharp, top, bitter, good, all this duality is because of the mind. Identity because of the mind. Time, space because of the mind. Form because of the mind. It is the same mind that takes you to formless when the form is dropped, meaning after death, and same mind takes the form again. Jiva. Jiva, meaning with the mind, with vasanas, with all the trails. So, same mind is form and formless. Supposing there is no mind, there is no mind. No question of form, formlessness. So, no mind state will only help us to get out of form and formlessness. Because formless also becomes a form later. A fellow dies. What is that goes out of him? Formless. That fellow is born again, formful. Punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, punarapi janane jatare sejanam govindam bhaja mudamate bhaja govindam bhaja mudamate. So, this life, the form, formlessness. Punarapi janane, again born, again, again, born and reborn. He has got a form, after death, formless, again a form. This cycle will continue so long there is this mind, ego, identity, duality, I, mine, thine, all this is because of mind. Jiva, individual. When this mind is gone, is Deva, God, that's all. Jiva is Deva. To put it in a mathematical form, Deva plus mind is equal to Jiva. Jiva minus mind is Deva. Am I clear? I'm not a student of mathematics. Jiva, individual soul, minus mind is cosmic soul or God. Cosmic soul, God, with mind is Jiva, individual soul. So, difference between individual soul and cosmic soul, individual mind and cosmic mind, is only the mind. When one's mind is dropped, he'll get out of this form and formlessness. Only one way, meditation. There is no other way. Because if you worship, then Bhagavan, I worship. Duality. Deva, Jiva. Finish. If I worship. Take prasadam, duality. Name, duality. All this is mind. When one duality is gone, you are non-dual. You are beyond form and formlessness. Meaning, form and formlessness, born, repeated, that's called birth and rebirth. By meditation, when you come out of that cycle, it is called liberation or moksha. Liberation or moksha is nothing but coming out of the cycle of birth and rebirth. So these are the minds that come to mind as I think of form and formlessness so eloquently presented by the speakers this morning. I just wanted to put it in my own style, taking all examples from Baba's literature. Baba says this way, flower has a form, right? The smell of a flower. Smell of a flower, has it a form? No. Flower is at one place, but the smell? All over. So formless smell is all over. Formful flower is at one place. There is a form, that is formlessness. Mother at one place. Mother loves everybody. And every mother loves her child. Is there any mother who doesn't love her child? They may be useless fellows who may not like their mothers. But every mother loves them. There's no exception to this. No exception. Mother has a name and a form. But her love? No name, no form. Your mother may be there in South Africa. When I tell you I know your mother, she's a good lady. And, yes, sir. Some vibration in you. And if she's a great devotee, tears of joy come out of you. Your father, your parents, tears of joy. But they are not here, they are there in South Africa. Meaning, love is formless. Smell, formless. Taste, formless. Laddu has a name and form. Sweetness, so, formlessness is all pervasive. But one thing is this. Laddu, you know that. Mysore pak, do you know? Mysore pak, the quadrangular thing. Bar, like something like bar soap, sweet. Pie, you know that then. All these are sweets. All these are sweets. Sweets are many, but sweetness is one. So that sweetness which is one is formless. And the sweets which are many are forms. So form to formless, these are the views which I could present to you within the limited time. And I have got to be aware of the time factor that you have got to go back to the canteen and have your lunch. Formful food there. And we with a form should have the food with a form to get energy which is formless. The energy that we get out of the food is formless. Therefore, I conclude with this, thanking you, appreciating you for your gracious presence here, and invite one or two questions if you have any, or one or two doubts that need clarification. This is my habit. Lecturing one way, going, saying, thank you, that I don't like it. I appreciate if you ask me any doubts or seek any clarification. Thank you. Yes, any clarification, doubts, please. Yes.
You mentioned that you know, the form and formless is a circle that's ongoing, and that we need to get rid of the mind, we need to get that the state of meditation. What is a description or a simplest way or to practice this meditation?
Good. The question is, what is the method of meditation? What is the practice? Thank you, sir. You have given us the best man from South Africa who is helping us a lot. Thank you. Meditation, there is no method. There is no method. If you make it a method, it is mechanical. If you make it a method, it is time and space bound. If you make it method, it is mind-based, mind strategy. So the strategy of the mind cannot be spiritual. If it is a method, it's a robot programming of the computer, it cannot be spiritual. Simple example. What is the method to love? Would you tell me? The method to love. Love is natural. Love is spontaneous. There is no method. But if I tell you, meet that person in the morning 6 o'clock, afternoon 12 o'clock, evening 4, 6, this is the method. That method may fail in somebody's case. See, this fellow is meeting me regularly. Shut up, get up. A method may not be valid for other person. Methods are not universal. Christians one method, Muslims another method, pranayama one method, yoga another method, so many methods. But to me, as Baba says, anything that makes you forget yourself in total identification with the job on hand is meditation. So Baba says, driving, eating, walking, talking, everything is meditation. When I'm talking now, I'm not thinking of my family. When I'm talking now, I'm not thinking of Kurvandha. I'm thinking of the subject, how best to convey the little knowledge I know. This is meditation. You are listening to me. You are not thinking of your return ticket. You are not thinking whether today's pizza day or not. You are not thinking of evening's talk, who is going. You are totally focused on me and the subject I am speaking. Listening is meditation. Speaking is meditation. Driving is meditation. Walking is meditation. Everything is meditation. But if you think getting up at 6 o'clock, 4 o'clock, sit straight, you may have back pain, but not the advantage of it. Am I clear? Any other question, please? Yes. Okay, if you repeat that, all can hear that question.
In your book you said that everything happens with God's will. And thereafter you said, but God is a witness. So if something, and how do you correlate that? Witness and the will.
Good. Wow. I never thought that South Africa has got such amazing standards. Very, very high standard. Very good. Very good. I'm very much excited, thrilled about it. Hats off to your intellectual spirit of inquiry into the depths of philosophy. I'm very happy. Because people have got only question, what does he eat? What does he wear? Has he gone? Will he come back? Stop that now. This is important. You see, every glass, mirror, will have chemical on the other side, right? Other side. One side you can see, other side you cannot see, because there is chemical, right? Am I right? All mirrors are like that. Am I right or not? Right? One side you can see yourself, the other side you cannot see because of chemical. How many mirrors are there? Two or one? Only one. Why don't you see on one side? Why don't you see your image on the other side? Because of chemical. Why are you able to see the other side? There is no chemical. Similarly, that chemical is mind. That mirror is individual. The individual with chemical, yes, identity. Without that, divinity. Same. On one side, I-ness. On the other side, you. This side, I, that side, you. Am I clear? Same. Difference is the chemical mind. That's one. Number two, I said that God is the witness. Correct. God, suppose you go to sleep. We sleep in the night. You have gone to deep sleep. I was about to sleep at the meeting, therefore I got up. Because some students also were sitting there. I'm just getting into Samadhi state. I'm afraid I'm a snore also. Boys tomorrow will tell me, sir, when you are snoring, can't we sleep after all? So to save my skin, I left the hall. So when I go to deep sleep, what happens? Is there the body? You do not know. You are sleeping. Is there the mind? You do not know. Even if you kill anybody, you do not. Anybody may kill you. You do not know. There is no mind, there is no body, there is no intellect. Nothing. You are lying on bed. Night 12 o'clock. Aha. Very good sleep. Particularly during Nagarsankirtan time, we get excellent sleep. People want to disturb us, then what to do? Nagarsankirtan time sleep, cool breeze and all the wind. So, in deep sleep, there's no body, there's no mind, there's no intellect. What is there? There's nothing there? If there's nothing, you can throw it into Chitravati. What is there? The witness. The witness divine is there. He's lying down. Later he gets up, mind gets awake. Later he'll brush his teeth, body comes in it. When he goes to brush his teeth, body. When he gets up, mind. When he sleep, witness. I got that. So, body, the body, mind and intellect. Body and the mind get in the waking state. They are withdrawn in the witness. Same witness with the body and mind is the waking state. Same witness only with the mind is dream state. Same witness without body and the mind is deep sleep state. Witness takes all these three. Meaning, at home, one is the father. In the community, he is a friend. In the office, he is the boss. Same fellow. Sitting in a rotating, revolving chair, boss. Keeping his arm over the other fellow, he is the friend. Making the son sit on the back, he is the father. Same fellow. So same witness functions in these three levels. Am I clear? Yes.
One says true meditation is to live in absolute truth. Can you explain that?
Say it loudly. Everybody will follow. Yes.
Sir, Swami says true meditation is to live in absolute truth. How do you explain that?
Truth is one. But when we apply to the world, it is a relative truth. Truth as applied to the world is a relative truth. Truth fundamentally is absolute truth. Relative truth and absolute truth are different. Temperature, very hot now. Night, better. So is it absolute truth? No. Relative truth changes. Absolute truth is changeless. Absolute truth is changeless. Relative truth goes on changing. America climate, very cold. Here, quite hot. Summer, hottest. So, climate, temperature, creation, nature, they go on changing. That which changes is relative truth. That which does not change is absolute truth. Now, 20 years ago, I think I was quite handsome. Now, relatively poor. After 10 years, relatively, comparatively, by all standards, horrible and terrible. Because with the age. Now I may attract people now. Later, people will avoid me. Because I'm not presentable. This is a fact. But same man, in high school, college, university, 40 years experience speaking, same man. After 10 years, you avoid me, same man. So, relative goes on changing. Same man is absolute. The spirit, the soul, the consciousness is changes, absolute truth. The body, the mind, relative truth. The mind which was highly romantic at one time is totally romantic now. Same mind, relative. So the relative is that which goes on changing. Outwards, within there is absolute truth. That's what it is. You follow me?
Isn't that your asatoma sadgamya tamasoma jyotika? What you've explained.
You want me to close that?
No, I say when you chant that, that's what you explain now.
Yes. From untruth to truth. Untruth is relative, truth is absolute truth. Untruth is relative truth. Tamas is ignorance, jyoti is awareness. Death to immortality, mrityu amrutanga, immortality. Good, sir.
Om Salam, thank you for firstly meeting all our South Africans. My question is today, in South Africa for years, we've been following, for example, if a person passed away, we do the 11-day prayer. Now I want to know, is it correct that we're doing it, or tell me the reason for that?
Offering prayer when one passes away, that's what you said. Yeah. We can pray even when one is alive. Why should you wait that one should pass away to pray? Even to live, we have to pray. After death, we pray for the soul to rest in peace. In the case of human beings. In the case of human normal beings, we pray for the departed soul to rest in peace. Because that soul will take the body again, formless to form. Until then, let that soul live in peace. But in case of avatar, it is only withdrawal. They can come back anytime, they can take out the body anytime. It depends upon their will. And so we pray to the divine will, not the withdrawal, not the entry into the body. Entry or exit is immaterial. We pray the divine will, the divine supreme consciousness, the divinity which is eternal, our prayers to that. Not that which comes and goes. Am I clear? Why prayer in respect of avatar is to elevate us? When avatar is no more in the physical body, my prayer is for my elevation. But in other cases, I pray for the other soul to rest in peace. This is for myself, that is for the other departed soul. Understood.
So I think the main point you are trying to get at is, do we follow culture and tradition? That's exactly what she's asking. In her culture, you know, it is a ritual to do a certain prayer at a certain time when people die. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah.
Okay. So do we follow that culture? As it is, it's from the forefathers down to, you know, everyone has got different cultures, you know.
My good friend, it depends upon your seriousness, your commitment. I'm very, very sorry to say a fact. Nobody can deny. They bring priests to do some rituals for the departed soul. And these fellows will ask the priest to complete as early as possible. As early as possible. I'll give you 10 rupees more if you complete 10 minutes before. Are you serious about it? Are you sincere about it? So the rituals are meaningless if we are not sincere about them. Rituals only exhibitionism if we are not honest about it. Rituals are expensive, external, outward, if we do not apply in the true spirit. That's why Baba says, if you shed one tear in memory of the departed soul, it is the highest, greatest, topmost ritual. Distribute 5,000 to everybody. Enjoy gala lunch. Hopeless fellow, stupid number one. A black marketer. Think of them. Supposing I said, think of my father, and I think of the love that I had for him. Here in Malab, here. Okay, sir, am I clear? So it is more the feeling that's important. Okay, thank you.
Sorry, just a little bit of clarity on that matter, because I know it affects all of us. After my father passed away, we all had the same question. And I took and read and tried to discuss the Garuda Puran. All the answers are there and the reasons are there. And if you believe in it, it will help you tremendously. The Garuda Puran.
I can tell you, sir, Garuda Puran is a text which is read when any near and dear passes on, containing so many kinds of penalties and punishments one would get. That is for ordinary level, for those who are yet to get into a metaphysical plane. At the physical plane, Garuda Purana is good, something like Ramayana. But Ajhatma Ramayana, for a higher level. So Garuda Purana speaks of punishments. If you commit a murder, you go to hell, there'll be so many fellows with the frying pans, with hot oil, potato chips, you'll be fried there. So if that is true, how much of hell you need for all these fellows that die? How many pans, so how many things of oil? How many cooks and kinds of things to fry? That's true. Symbolic, to make ordinary folks to be afraid of sin, fear of sin, love of God, that's correct at that level. If you go to evolve to a higher level, you will understand there is nothing like sin or merit. The mind makes it sin or merit. In my younger days, to go abroad is a sin. Yes. సప్త సముద్రాలు దాటితే మహాపాపం అని పేరు మా చిన్నప్పుడు. టుడే ఇఫ్ యూ డోంట్ గో అబ్రాడ్ ఇట్ ఇస్ అ సిన్, వర్స్ట్ సిన్ టుడే. సో వాట్ ఈస్ అ సిన్, వాట్ ఈస్ అ మెరిట్? చాలా ఈ ఐ కాంట్ టెల్ దిస్ టు ఆల్ దీస్ పీపుల్ అవుట్ సైడ్ ఆర్డినరీ పీపుల్ ప్రొఫెసర్స్. ఇఫ్ ఐ టెల్ దాట్ దే విల్ బి డిమోరలైజ్డ్. ఐ షుడ్ టెల్ దెమ్ గరుడ పురాణ. అరైట్, if you treat me, be ready, you are going to be Puri tomorrow. Amma, please be careful.
Asato.
శివాయ
శివాయ
Shiva Shivaya Namah Shivaya.